This is Bob Yoder. I am cousin to Jacque, and who we're here to celebrate her life today. And so I want to welcome you on behalf of the Swaney family. John is not able to be here, but on the table, as you're exiting, on the left there's a table right there. Opportunity for you to write an encouraging note to John. Try to keep it light, but he just loves hearing from different ones, and so feel free to do that, and I think that'll be a good way to acknowledge John. The other members of the Swaneys are here. I'm not going to be able to name all of the grandchildren. However, Mike and Emily are there to do that.
Arrangement.
And so, God, I thank you for this day, the opportunity that we have to gather in this way, family and friends. God, you are good. And your word tells us that you are the God of all comfort. And so we ask for that today. We ask for your comfort to reside here. God, you are the God of joy that we can look to. Thank you for each one that's here. I pray for your blessing now upon us in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the things that, as we were setting up last evening, had to turn the lights out so you could see the words that you're going to sing here in just a moment. But so I don't mind being in the dark. This isn't about me, it's about Jacque. But last evening as we were setting up, Emily was telling us that if Jacque were here and setting up, she would be humming. That's just how she did. She did house chores, she was humming. And she was always in that mood. And so she enjoyed music. And so we're going to sing today. We're going to sing some songs. And we're going to start with this one. Oh, that would be glory. You know this one? You're going to know it here pretty soon. So there we go.
Kindness, humility, trust, hopefulness, and perseverance. One of her favorite hymns was His Eyes on the Sparrow. The verses of this song apply so much to Grandma's life. The song verse, I sing because I'm happy, is one of them. Grandma was always humming, as we heard earlier. She would hum in the car, she would hum in the kitchen, she would hum while cleaning, walking, she hummed through chemo that she had to go through. She hummed in the classroom, hummed on the beach, hummed while camping, quilting. She did so many things, and she hummed through all of those things. Anytime, anywhere, even while sleeping. We're not sure. She hummed. She hummed because she was happy. And she hummed because she was free. Her joy was a divine joy. And another verse from that song says, why should I feel discouraged? Grandma had plenty of times and she could have felt discouraged. At the age of six, she did not get to meet her baby brother who did not make it home from the hospital after birth. At 41 and 52, she was diagnosed with two different forms of breast cancer. At 72, she was diagnosed with colon cancer. At 74, she was diagnosed with vascular dementia. And at 75, she had a stroke. But despite the shadows that came, she was not discouraged, as she knew who was watching over her, just like he who watches over the sparrow. Another song verse says, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Grandma had many times in her life where doubts and fears could have taken a hold. She consistently rested on his goodness. It was 1974, and my grandparents felt called to go to the mission field. They had two children, my father Mike and my aunt Emily. They then moved to Portland, I'm sorry, they moved from Portland to Manila in July of 1974. There were countless times while on the mission field that they truly had to rest in his goodness, losing their doubts and fears. Moving across the ocean to a new country, relying on promised support for their expenses, packing a crate with anything they couldn't put in luggage and not seeing that crate for months. That sounds like a story, but I think we're gonna expound on that here. Finding friends and family stateside to manage their logistics, adjusting to limited communication like limited phone, limited radio, power outages, water issues, often leading to hauling water and boiling water, and countless other unknowns. Adjusting to driving in foreign country and countless car problems, flooding and illness, Mike contracting the measles. Is that true? Did you contract the measles then? Okay, someone contracted measles. And Grandpa contracted a kidney infection, all while Grandma was pregnant with Uncle Matt. So there were a lot of things going on. There were rats, roaches, beetles, mosquitoes, head lice, pregnancy, and the birth of my Uncle Matt. Such a cool uncle. He was so cool. One story from my Aunt Emily. Grandma was sleeping and felt a tickle by her mouth. It was a 3-inch cockroach sucking on her saliva. She quickly swatted it away and kept on humming. She rested on his goodness, losing the fear of these roaches and even adapting an ability to control them. Her words sent to her sister in a letter on May 8, 1975, while 5 months pregnant with my Uncle Matt, "I just hit a cockroach from 3 feet away with a shoe by throwing it. He was flying, so I couldn't sneak up on him." Oh boy. She found joy in that roach moment, I'm sure. It would be 20 years later, she would have a pet tarantula named Harry in her classroom and let him crawl up her arm. She gave those Marine Corps children a glimpse of what it was like to lose your fear in faith. Her faith was truly the foundation of her life. Words weren't even needed as she lived her faith in action. And I guess I will share something. I would go to my grandma and grandpa's house really often. I think it was a few years ago, I was probably like 23 or 24, and I would go there, and they were going to a Bible study with all these Marines and all these young couples and families, and they would always invite me. And I would tell her and Grandpa, I would say, "Yeah, I'm gonna go with you," you know. But I just did not go. And then one day I was there at their house doing laundry, and they said, "We're leaving out the door, we're going to that Bible study we've told you about numerous times." And I had to go. I was like, "All right, I've been saying I was gonna go, now's the time." So I went, and that Bible study was one of the best Bible studies I've ever been to. I mean, the community, the fellowship there, Grandma and Grandpa, Grandma especially, she was really telling me to go. They knew what I needed at that time, and that was just so helpful from them. And she's just always pointing the right direction. She always was, and I'm really thankful to her for that. And another story. When she retired from her teaching career at Oceanside Schools, the staff had a retirement celebration at her school with another teacher creating a slideshow. The song he chose for her slideshow was "I Can Only Imagine." Oh.
thanks to Jackie Matuza for preparing that slideshow. And, at this time, one or several of the grandsons are going to come. One. Caleb, come and read the scripture for us. Can you see it in the dark here?
Yeah. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And then I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with men. He will live them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for older of things has passed away." Few words that I wanted to share this afternoon. I entitled what I've got here to share, "Everything's All Right." Doesn't that sound like Jackie? Everything's All Right. You know, Jackie was 6 years older than I, but my recollection of growing up was with the many family reunions that we would have. We would have reunions almost every year together. And this particular picture was taken in 1956. That's me right in the center. Oh, I want to point out, that's my brother, Mike. Looks like he's levitating. Uncle Bud had Mike on his palm of his hand, kind of like he was delivering food at a waitress table or something like that. Anyhow, and there's Jackie. She was, as I said, 6 years older than I. We had gatherings quite often as family, and that's what I remember. But because she was that
that older, I didn't really hang around with her that much. I was more playing around with Tony and Jan there. And I'm glad they're here today because I can play around with them again. One year, 26 years later, after the 1956 photo, our family went to the Western Mennonite School in West Salem, North Salem, and we gathered at that flagpole out in the center there and took this picture. At the time this picture was taken, some of the family had already left, so the actual gathering was much, much larger. But as I looked at this picture, and I don't expect you to see all the faces and recognize everybody there, but as I looked at that picture and kind of counted all the number of family that is there, about half of them are where Jackie's at right now, enjoying that time together once again. What a day that will be. On occasion, I would prepare a song to sing at these gatherings. I won't share all of those songs, but on this particular time, and this is the reason why I showed this picture, I prepared a song that highlighted each member of my mom's side of the family, so her sisters and her brother and all of that, and the verses all talked about or sang about everyone in our family, our cousins and all of them, named them all. I'm not going to go through all of that, but I want to share with you the verse I had written for the Conrad side. So the verse went like this. I won't sing it, I'll just read it. Fern, that was Jackie's mom, Fern is accustomed to moving. No telling where they will alight. There's miles, miles, miles they have gone. Her feet is sore, but his smile's bright. They follow the sun to wherever. True snowbirds, they are always in flight. Punky would like to arrest them. But Jackie says, no, it's all right. As we thought about coming together here, that story came back to mind for me in that song and sharing that at that time. And back in 1982, that's who Jackie was to me. That's how I remembered her, and that's how I still remember her, that everything is all right. Everything is all right. Jesus said these words. He said, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. What's Jesus saying there? He's saying everything's all right. Everything is all right. And that's exactly the spirit and the heart that I remember my cousin Jackie. Because you went to the store and got something new for yourself. It's new because it's unprecedented. It's never been seen before. Imagine that. I can only imagine, is what Jackie would say. Now she's seeing some reality to all of that. Granted, the passage is talking about a creation that is yet to come, that Jackie is experiencing a creation right now that Jesus has prepared for her. He told his disciples, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. When he finished her mansion, her room, it was ready. He took her to be with him. My Jackie, my wife and I, recently took a trip. We made reservations at different motels. We stopped camping years ago, but we made reservations at different hotels. I remember one time showing up and our room wasn't ready. And then, a few hours later, I got a text and said, your room is ready. Jackie's room was ready for her. And she's there now, enjoying that experience with her Lord, with her mom and dad, with those who have gone before. These are some of the scenes of the Philippines that I like to think that Jackie probably saw. Maybe she was alluding to that in the eulogy that was read. You may have to remember that was talked about. How that the beauty of God's creation that we currently live in was there, and she enjoyed it. She moved from the Philippines to Seaside, Oregon, and witnessed the beauty of that part of the world, the creation there. Oceanside, California, and the pier, and imagine the sunsets that were there. Imagine she just enjoyed all of that because that's who she was. She loved the ocean and the beach. Not only did she enjoy those creation, that part of the world in which God had placed her, the creation in which he had, but she also loved the animals that were around her. Her pets growing up, the cat and the dog and the tarantula and the monarch butterfly. She had a love for God's creation and everything that was there. If God created and gave us that this time around, I can only imagine what he is bringing for us in the new creation. We can only imagine. Ephesians 3:20 says, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine." That's what we can't even imagine what it's totally going to be like. What a glorious day that will be. So, everything's going to be all right because we'll have a new creation. Everything's going to be all right because there's a new communion. Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. In 1969, I lived with Jacque and John Swaney in Portland. This is the home they had on Southeast 81st near Burnside. I was in the basement. Mike was around then, but I don't believe Emily and Matt had come along just yet. John and Jackie had a nook in the back of their house, in the, just off the kitchen there where we would gather to eat. You remember that, Mike? I don't know if you remember this. Mike would sit in the back in the nook. And so, and then I would sit next to him, and then Jackie was there to bring the food to the table and all of those things. Invariably, when we would sit down to eat and the prayer had been said, Mike would say, "I have to go to the bathroom." And I would have to get out and make room for Mike to get through. It was just an experience. But the thing of it is, the reason I share that story is because when I came to live with them, I got to know them. They got to know me. Jackie got to understand what I liked and didn't like. I overheard her one time talking on the phone, because John, I think you lived with them for a little while too, before I did. But I remember her saying on the phone to whoever she was talking to, "He's a little more studious than John was." She got to know me. That's what living together does to us. Jackie had been a cousin, and like I said, I didn't really associate a whole lot with her when we would get together because she was a little older than me. But when living with her there, it was like she had become a big sister to me. And it was like we had that family tie, so to speak. When God comes to live with us in that new creation, we are going to know him far more than you think you even know him now. Maybe you're a believer here today and you think, "Oh, I know God and I'm in a relationship with him and I have this good communion with him." But it's amazing what's coming yet for us. When God comes to live and dwell with us, Oh, the dwelling of God in the Old Testament was, they had the tabernacle, and that's where they went to, in order to experience God. And then they got to Jerusalem, and the temple was built, and that's where they went. But yet they couldn't go all, even into that Holy of Holies, because the curtain was there and blocking that intimate, close relationship with God. Jesus came into earth, onto earth, and he was told, Joseph and Mary were told that his name was to be Emmanuel, because it meant God with us. Jesus was with us. When he died, better for us? Bring it on. No more sea. I don't know exactly what that means. Right now, the seas divide us as a people in the world. It separates us. If there's no more sea, maybe it means that we're going to all be together in unity and harmony. I don't know. I don't know if that's what it means. It says no more sea. No more. No more pain. There's going to be no more temple. The temple is the gathering place for worship of God. In our new condition, whether we are gathered or scattered, we will worship God. Whether we are scattered around different places in this new creation, or we are gathered together somewhere, our constant state will be able to worship, because his glory will surround us. The temple will be all that he has created for us. Our entire world at that time will be his temple, because he is there in all his glory. There'll be no more sun or moon. The brightness of the sun today, it's going to be 96 today, I understand, so hang in there. There'll be no more moon, the light of night. No more need for all of that. Why is that? I think it's because of the glory of God being present with us. He will be our light. There's no more shut gates. I don't know about you. When I go to bed at night, I usually go past the front door, make sure that. On this trip that my wife Jacque and I recently took, we did a driving trip down through New Mexico. Went all the way down to the southeast corner of New Mexico to Carlsbad Caverns. Have you ever been there? It's pretty amazing. 800 plus feet below the surface of the ground is where they take you. We took the elevator rather than walking down, but that's where we went. You get down there, and we were on a tour with a park ranger guide. When we got down there in the middle of that cave, he took and shut out all the lights. Complete darkness. Could not see a thing. And then he took a candle and lit a single candle. It was amazing how that light penetrated in that darkness. And then that park ranger, a government employee, did something I never expected. He sang Rock of Ages. He sang Rock of Ages. And it chills up your spine, because here, all this rock surrounding us, and he hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock. What a great thing. Well, in eternity, there's no more darkness. There's no more night. There's no more of that sort of thing, because his light has penetrated the darkness. There's no more impurity, no more curse. You know what that means? No more sin. All of the things that go on, that you see going on in this world today, the wars and the fighting and the riots and the hatreds and the murders and the crime that's rampant, there's no more of that. No more curse. Through Jesus, we've been saved from the penalty of sin. That's the justification that he's given to us, declaring us not guilty. We've been saved from the penalty of sin. We are being saved from the power of sin. That's the Spirit of God within us that's helping us to conquer the sinful tendencies in our life. that we will be saved from the presence of sin in eternity. There's no sin there. And finally, there's no more lamps. No more lamps. At our house, I shared with you about locking the doors. The other thing I do is I've got to New Mexico. A timer was there working, and so if somebody was casing our house, there's somebody there. Let's not go there. I don't know if that works or not, but that's what I do. But there's no more need for those kinds of lamps. There's no more need. Everything's secure. Everything's bright. Everything's lit. Jesus is the light. While he was here on earth, he said this, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness." Praise God. What a day that will be. The no mores of eternity. There are 13 of them. Whenever I preach, I always say at the end, so what? So as I come to so what, you know we're getting close to the end. Everything's all right because we are going to experience this new creation. We will have a new communion. We are going to be under a new condition. Jacque is experiencing most of those things right now. In fact, all of them. She's experienced a new creation because there's a heavenly home God had prepared for her. She's experiencing this new communion because he is right there with her, absent from the body, present with the Lord. And she's experiencing a new condition. No more death, no more sorrow, no more pain. These are my grandparents, Chris and Mamie Yoder. It's because of these that Jacque and I are cousins. That's how that works. I never knew Chris and Mamie. They died before I was born. But one of the stories that my mom told me years ago was about her mom, Mamie, and when she came near to the end of her life, she acquired uranium poisoning. At that time, the doctors couldn't do a whole lot for her. And when they told the family that was the case for her, Mom shared with me how that her mom lay in her deathbed, gathered the family around, my Aunt Mid, my Aunt Dawn, my Aunt Fern, my mom, my Uncle Bud, and her husband, Chris, gathered them around, and she sang, "Everything's all right in my father's house." That spirit of that song, this is just a little simple little chorus, but that spirit of that song passed on to Jacque as she lived her life, such that everything was all right, and that's how she expressed it. She had that confidence. I think that's why she was able to hum wherever she went. Everything's all right. Mom shared with me at that time that Mamie had sung two verses to that song. Since then, I've learned that there are multiple verses, you know, many verses. And I don't remember Mom ever telling me exactly what the second verse was that Mamie sang. But I like to think that the second verse was, "Will I meet you there? Everything's all right in my father's house, and will I meet you?" Just before getting into the passage that we just read, that we have focused on here today, right at the end of chapter 20, it says this, "If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." If you're here today and your name's not found in that book, you're not going to be part of a new creation and a new communion and a new condition. Well, things will be new for you, but it will not be pleasant. I think Jacque wants us to know that she wants to meet us there. I want to meet her there. Will I meet you there in my Father's house? One of the things that is back on the table there is this bookmark that was made, and thanks to Emily's neighbor, I believe, for putting that together. But it expresses some of the things that that Jacque would have said here today. And the emphasis that I saw in it is that she would say, trust in the Lord. Trust in God. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. Lord God, I thank you for Jacque's life. I thank you, God, that the message she can leave with us today and bring to us today is that everything's all right. Everything's all right here. There is no...
Get out of the way. if you could do that, then those of us who are going to be rearranging here can have a little more room to do that. And then we'll have it fixed up right real quick, and you come back in here and have a light lunch with us. Okay? All right? Good with that? All right. Let me say this Thanksgiving to God. God, we just thank you again for the glorious life that you've given to us in knowing Jacque.
And God, I pray that as we spend this time now in fellowship and discussion and talking together, sharing together memories and thoughts of things of the past, God, that it'll still be ringing in our heart that everything's all right. Thank you, God. Thank you for our time together. Bless the food that we are about to eat. And keep us well that we can serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's do it.